Go, go.
Okay.
You get yours? Good deal.
Well, Bob, that was some exciting shooting that you had with Dave. Now, on this next hunt, this is the one where you shoot your 100,000th crow in 28 seasons.
That's correct, Ryan.
And you did that in the middle of a 551 bird shoot.
That's correct.
Bob, how do you know that you shot 100,000 crows?
Well, Ryan, I keep meticulous records, and I know every crow shot and every shell fired.
Wow. Well, without further ado, let's watch Bob Aronson shoot his 100,000th crow.
This here is a central roost, and as you can see in back of me, you never want to shoot this. These birds feel secure like this if you leave them alone in the bloody roost. All these tens and tens of thousands of them are all going out to feed in the morning. If Ryan and I even remotely get ourselves halfway in the right spot this morning, we'll get a darn good shoot this morning. Darn good. Look at all of them passing off down south there, Ryan.
I'll get the low end. Oh yeah, I see him. He hooks around, dog. He might give me a shot. Yeah, he might. That was a high baby, brother. Here comes a low one right from the north. Got a low one coming. Oh, there's a pair. They'll come right over me, I can kill them, Highland. Here comes the low one from the north. Oh. I see him. I see him. That might be it from the west. I think I can get him. Just about dead north of me. Here come two on the left. On the left. Thank you. Thank you, Ryan. Yeah, I think he's going to do it. He's in the northwest now, Ryan. I'm going to take it right about now. I won't let go by. Well, as long as it keeps coming, I'll keep on. Goodbye! There's one on the left. See him coming with his wings set. Yeah, I see him. Another one coming from the northwest. If he's gonna come or not. Yeah, I see him. I see him. When he comes up over here, I'm gonna whop him. Yeah, he'll give us a good shot. Another one. Get some more hung up here. Well, because this is an afternoon shoot and we're about a mile and a quarter away from the roost and it's a nice day again, and if they fly late, my normal decoys that I use, it takes a while getting them out of the trees. Where these, I know we're going to be shooting probably at least right up till sundown or maybe a little bit after sundown, and if any of these get left hanging in the trees, it's no big deal. So not only that, but if I have to, I can shake these out of here pretty well. And not only that, they look pretty darn lifelike too. Just at my other decoys, I can get up on the tree much higher with that extension pole that I've got. This one's gonna get dissected. Oh, man, did that hurt. Oh. Hello, he's coming, Ryan. He's right here, right where you like him to be whoppered. Get ready. I'm gonna take him pretty quick. Tyron comes over if he does. There's one diving him straight over me. Another one off west here. I'll get the one on the north side. Oh, look at this out front. I'll get the high one. Hey, yes, sir. Oh, yeah. you have time on him? You did? You know what that he was shot with? That was there. I got about maybe 100 more nines left. That bird was knocked out of the air with a 20 gauge. Right. Got some more in the north coming, maybe. Maybe they'll give me a shot. Okay. I see them. One coming back from the north. He dipped over this way, that turkey. There's one. Another one coming, same spot. Boy, that was a long bird. There's another long one. Oh, a bisection. There's one coming back to you, yeah, too. There's one. He's still coming back again. Here come a couple of more from the northwest. One. Oh, there's two. Give me a shot. Thanks, Ryan. I see him. Okay. I see him coming. He's coming. And I will be ready. Now I got the 12 in my hands here. Uh-oh. Oh, can you believe that? Can you believe that? Terrible. Here comes another one. Northwest. saw it. Oh, there's a good pass. Oh, I had to be underneath that second bird in order to connect with him. Beat it off a little. Oh, here comes some more. Oh, yeah. This is the one. Yep. Yep, this is it. Here it comes. It's the ball! Hey, all right. Tough shot. That's 100,000 in 28 years. Yeah, well, I didn't shoot him sitting down. After all,
I might have to do that 100,000.
Yes, sir. There's 198 on there so far. And I keep track of them in the air cells because I see it on my average. And that's a conservative count. Because I only count the ones that I see go down. I see others where their body's shot. Okay.
I had to take a break here.
And here's another one coming on the left. There's another one. Okay, well now we got 200.
Interview, but it's such a momentous occasion.
Yep.
We still have
sure. Absolutely. The
club is now at 100,002, and there's another one dropping in over these shoulders.
Yep. Morning call deluxe. Oh, there's a pair.
Okay. You think you can spare a second for Foster to get back?
I'll try to. But remember, we're in the midst of battle here.
Turn around. I can't interrupt you. This
okay.
Silly.
Uh-oh. That's got him. That's what happens when you raise your head a little. Yeah?
We've got a break here.
Okay. At any rate, you were asking me how do I know how many over a period of years. Hey, I keep records of them, how many I shoot each month, how many shells I shoot each month, how many shells each shoot. I've got it all broken down. At the beginning of this year, before I ever shot a single crow, I needed 485 crows to hit 100,000. Uh-oh. Oh, tough shot here. Oh, did that hurt? Hang on a minute here and I'll get another deal in here. Just a sec, Ryan. I gotta load up Big Bertha here. Here's one right here. He almost fell right in the blinds with it. Here's another one coming from the north. Ooh, what he's going to get done to him. Oh. I missed that high turkey that he should have been had. I think fatigue is setting in just a little.
Well, summarize here. Briefly.
Okay, go ahead.
You just shot about 10 or 11 crows a day.
Yeah.
You just shot your 100,000th crow in 28 years.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
So congratulations, Bob.
Thank you.
I'm so thankful you let me be a part of this.
Well, thank you, Ryan. Thank you. And at the beginning of this year, before this year started, I had fired over 141,000 rounds of ammo at crows.
And in carry, you maintain an average of...
It's about 70%. you know?
That's pretty good.
Yeah. I mean, it'll vary, it'll fluctuate from shoot to shoot, you know? This shoot here will carry a good average because they're coming in real good. But at any rate, I keep telling people that they have a brain smaller than a damn ping pong ball and they're smarter than 99% of the people that hunt them, including me. So, well, at any rate, we're going to get back to it because we got some more customers coming. There's two. Hey, guys. Look at him diving with his legs down. Oh, there's a pair. Boy, that first one got wild. Here comes one. What? Whoa, here a mad one. He's out north of us. He's on the east side of the host today. Coming right in. See, hold on to the wind, Ryan. As soon as he comes over, I'm going to hit him. Yeah, two of them coming from the north. There's one up high, right above me. I'm going to shoot the low one. Right in the timber, I'm going to shoot the low one, Ryan.
If you're going to hunt crows, and you want to learn to blow a hand call, the best one that I've ever used is a hand call, they call them a mallard tone. They make them in Moline, Illinois. They're the best that I've ever used. I've used them since 1965, and the reason why I prefer them so much over any of the other calls on the market is because of the tonal quality in these calls. Also, you can hit the higher notes with this particular crow call that I can't get out of another particular brand of crow call, and I'm going to demonstrate that for you right now. Also, if you're going to use a good clighting call, that's where you also need some good high notes, of which I will demonstrate for you here real quick. Those real high type notes of pop, 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 pop like that, you can't get them with other crow calls. Another item that we used, Ryan and I, on the first trip this year, incidentally, was this Deceptor decoy right here. This really worked quite well in the wind because you had movement out there. And it was really kind of cool because what the crows thought, they thought it was another crow circling some of the dead crows that were on the ground. And man, I'm telling you, you talk about those babies diving into it. It was something. Other items that need to be mentioned too is when you're going to use a hi-fi when you're hunting them, just don't go with one hi-fi. Always have a backup unit. I carry three of them with me. And one of the main concerns that I hear is people don't get enough volume out of the hi-fis that they use. And you need to check the amplifiers in those units. Just because you have a unit made by a particular manufacturer, they do a lot of subcontracting work, so you might not have the same subcontractor do the same work on several different ones that you might own. That's why sometimes you'll have one hi-fi that'll be louder than another. So check those amplifiers in them, have them looked at. What we're going to do next is we're going to take a tour through the area so you can see the the 551 birds. It would take Ryan and I till sundown here to pick all those things up, but we'll take a tour through the area. But before we do that, I want to show you a great little product here that I've used for the last 25 years, and it's called Sheath by Birchwood Casey. They make it up in Eden Prairie, Minnesota, and this stuff works really, really well in cold weather where you don't have to worry about it freezing up. What they call it, they just call it a rust preventative, and it's really very, very good for moving parts, whether you're using a semi-auto or whether you're using a pump gun. I prefer, if I am going to shoot an auto, I'd rather shoot them dry myself. But with the pump guns, just from the residue, from the powder, and the amount of ammo that you pour through them, sometimes they get pretty dry, especially when they get hot, when you're shooting a lot of rounds through them. So I give them a shot of this stuff, and those babies work like glass again. And now, folks, we're going to take a tour through the area so you can see what was done yesterday afternoon in this spot. As we're going to be touring the area here where most of the crows fell, we're going to discuss a little bit on the road to 100,000. It took me approximately 16 years to shoot the first 50,000, and I remember I made a notation in one of the volumes that I've got, now I've got to get to work on the next 50,000. And quite honestly, I never thought I'd make it. So now that I'm there, I guess I can get to work on the next 100,000, but I don't think I've got enough years left in me to do it. Now we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna go on the other side of this hedgerow right here, where the birds were working their way right down through here yesterday afternoon. And the major kill area that we had, a lot of them dropped in here, but this is nothing compared to what fell on the other side. As you were watching the video, you could see from the film footage that the greater bulk of them were shot, landed on the west side of this hedgerow, and we're going to take a walk through there right now where you can take a look. What a massacre out here. You can tell the way the birds are laid out here too, where the bulk of them got shot, in what area in relation to the blind. But, I mean, they're just all over the place. It'd take us forever picking all these things up. We're gonna walk down through here a little bit so you can see just how far this goes on for. Ryan will take a walk with me. And bear in mind, we had the blind right over there where those dead birds are in the trees. This is one reason, Ryan, why a lot of those birds were hanging off to the west-hand side yesterday afternoon. I mean, there is crows everywhere in here. There's a pile of them over here. Oh, look at this. These are the ones here. A lot of these were the ones that were just coming over the trees and just getting smacked and landing in here. Bert Papowski once said that the amount of crows a man shoots during his crow hunting lifetime is only limited by the amount of time and energy he's willing to devote to the sport. And that sums it up in a nutshell, folks.